Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Served, presented by Chase. I'm Andy, he's John, Sicky Magoo, Buckaroo, Mike Hayden is not here in New York with us. We are currently in the East Village. Props to Melrose Podcast for letting us take over their space for the night. Mike, you got sick. No fun.
Yeah. That's what happens when you spend a weekend with family and kids.
Ugh.
One's bound to take you down.
I feel like you're speaking phlegm.
It's Flemish.
Yeah,
it's like Kim Clijsters. You're Flemish.
Not quite the same. Yeah, not the same thing. Okay, so for those of you who have seen our draw shows, we do the dumb thing where we pick all of the matches, and we're not just wrong once by saying Novak is going to win the tournament. We're wrong many, 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 many times, and we have fun with it. We know that we are ripe for Twitter to crush us, but not as bad. I mean, not as bad as Wimbledon. So what we're going to do is we're going to tell you what we got right, we're going to tell you what we got wrong, and we're going to redraw here at a second. But first, catch us up, JW. What's been going on at the U.S. Open? What are the storylines that are creeping across your screen?
Let's see, storylines. We had a lot of upsets, and they made for some fun night sessions. We are, by Labor Day, so we made the turn for Labor Day, we had no Coco, no defending champion.
No Coco.
We had no Novak, yep. No Djokovic. We had we can keep this theme going. Let's stop. We had no Carlos Alcaraz, and we had no Naomi Osaka. Those are arguably the four biggest draws in the sport, certainly among them. They were fun. There were some real upsets. Fans love upsets. It opens up the draw like a chasm. The draw yawns open. So the good news is there's a lot of opportunity. The less good news is there will be some Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday sessions where, I don't want to see the ESPN ratings, and you suspect there are a bunch of fans going out hoping to have gotten tickets to see Djokovic, and they're going to get players of lesser repute. But, I think, honestly, this tournament is at a place now where it is almost outcome independent. And it's a great show, and there's a lot to do, and it's fun to go out there. It's actually pretty good value when you amortize the hours spent. You're not going to have the stars this year. A lot of opportunity, though. There are so many players who you think must be saying to themselves, if not now, when?
Yeah, and a lot of Americans amongst them, which is exciting. If you have to fill a narrative with Carlos losing, that was the most shocking loss of the tournament, by the way. Yeah. I don't think... Right. Anyone would have bet you a ham sandwich with odds on. I'm going to try it. Vanda Zanskulp.
That's the guy who speaks Flemish.
Yeah, him and Mike Hayden.
That did not age well either. I mean, that guy was barely winning games in his subsequent match.
Yeah, and it was one of those ones where it felt so weird that the next one he played Draper, and it was like a no-doubter. I was choosing Draper straight away. So that was strange. We've been talking the last couple weeks about the Olympic hangover. And I feel like that head was pounding during the first week of this event. The people that kind of look fresher, the people that really grinded through Wimbledon into the Olympics, Novak, Carlos, at some point something's got to give. They've been playing intense playoff-level tennis for 4 months straight. And I know that's not like most people go to their job, they do their job, but something's got to give at some point.
You want my counter to that?
Please.
Bronze medal winner, Iga Świątek, number one seed, still in the draw. Silver medalist, Dana Vekic, played awfully well. Who did she lose to? She lost to. So listen to this. Zhenqin Wen, listen to this. She wins a gold medal, goes from Paris to Cincinnati, Ohio. There is a ceremony where the Chinese athletes that did well in the Olympics are requested back in Beijing. So she flies from Cincinnati to Beijing. It's like an hour flight. Just take a little puddle jumper. She flies from Cincinnati to China. In between Cincinnati and the U.S. How'd you spend your time between Cincinnati and the U.S. Open? Oh, I had a little photo shoot on a roof in Soho. No. She went back to China. I said it was CCP Airlines. Comes back to New York and is still doing well. She's blowing up this theory that the Olympics snapped everyone.
Well, no, bullshit. Okay. Because there's a difference between being on the upswing and being in the most exciting time of your entire life. And being Novak 20 years down the road and having done this shit for 2 decades and it being laborious, or, you know, the Chuckster's been going for 3 years straight. Like, he's been motoring for 3 years straight. So there is a difference between, like, I remember post US Open through like Saturday. I hosted Saturday Night Live and then played a match a day and a half later. Like, that's irresponsible. That is absolutely irresponsible. But at that moment, I felt fine.
Man,
yeah, like it was the best time ever. Like, so I do think there is a difference.
That's fair.
With build up over time and what gets you going. Queen Wen's probably still pumped about it all, right? This is the moment. She's still riding that wave.
She's been great here too. But yeah. No, I think she throws a bit of a wrench into this thesis that the Olympics sapped everyone. But no, I think that's a fair point. You'll be happy to know, by the way, Carlos Alcaraz, as busy as his schedule is, as low as his gas gauge is, he's coming to Charlotte in December. You can catch him.
December 6th. I know. I want to see it in person. It's pretty it's crazy. I mean, there's too much tennis, and also people will schedule cash grabs if they have the time. My argument would be, listen, if you want to handle your off season any way you want to handle it, that should be your prerogative. The term shouldn't be dictated to you. Big fan of like free markets in general and decision making and everything else. This late, I feel like we're like just talk about late matches all the time, and it's weird because I feel like we've become maybe a little bit more precious about the late finishes. It used to happen. I played, a match that ended at 3 a.m. in Australia and X, Y, and Z. What do you think? How big of an issue is this? Am I walking uphill both ways, or is this a real issue? And is it counterproductive to the sport in tennis at large?
It's a real issue. I just think it makes tennis look goofy, like unserious. Like, ha-ha, we finished. I think it has an impact of competition. It can't be fun to like restart your rhythms and get back to the hotel when the sun comes up. Here's my only thing. So jump in here. This is like a logic game you'd get like on a standardized test. The players don't want to start before 11 o'clock. Understandable, right? You need to hydrate. You need to wake up. So you can't start before 11. You don't want to play. Men want to play best of five sets. So that's off the table. Television wants not just two matches per session, but they want the courtside interviews. They want the hallway. That figures time in there. You can't have a night session of just one match the way the French do. You can't, in New York especially, start anytime before 7. You can't start a night session at 6:30. It's like something's got to give. And what ends up happening, and I don't know, can you move players to a different court when they've practiced on the center? I mean, it's one of these things where we all think it's ridiculous. We all think it's stupid. But I think coming up with solutions, really tough.
Well, okay, so the 11 a.m. thing, we choose to start Ash at 12. That's been an adjustment. That Ash doesn't start at 11.
Yeah,
Ash,
good point.
Ash starts at 12. So there's an hour. I don't know. I think you can start at 6:30 or at least advertise that you're gonna. Because when you say 7, when you write down starting time of 7,
right?
Interviews, warm up, everything else, you're 7:20, 7:25. So if you advertise 6:40 start, you're actually starting at about 7.
Right.
So I actually think you can cheat an hour to 11. I think you can cheat. I personally think you can cheat forward. A half hour. So listen, there is an issue. We forget that there used to be 3 matches during the day starting at 11.
Right,
so
right.
They got rid of one of the matches, started an hour later. I don't know why, as tennis players, we can't start at 10:30. Like, I get it.
No, we just bought ourselves 90 minutes.
Yeah. And then if you cheat a little bit forward, like, so everyone's coming up with these insane things. Like, start Ash at the same time that you start every other court.
Right.
Like, you have a couple of matches to spare. Maybe you, I don't know, maybe the players, you'd have to get them to agree to it, but I got to think that the players would approve a flex match. Like, maybe Ash, maybe another, I don't know. Like, there needs to be a solution, because there's just this uproar every time, and now I feel like we used to finish at 2 and like, oh man, that sucked for the players, and now it's like, it sucks for us.
Well, yeah, it's true.
Yeah, I get it, but
people have to go home after the matches and the ball kids.
John, you don't have to explain to me what it's like to finish a night match late in New York City.
Here's my question. It's 10 o'clock at night. You're the second match scheduled.
Ugh.
They split sets. Would you rather move to an outer court where you'd get on pretty fast, but you haven't practiced there, you don't know the dimensions.
You're proving your own point.
No, but what would you? I mean, I
wouldn't, because I played 40 some odd night sessions in that stadium for basically. I went played my first night match there in 2001 and didn't leave the court until 2011. So yes, or 2002. I had a couple out there. So one of the things as a top player, if you're playing someone early, 70, 80 in the world, I want the nerve factory.
I
want the nerve factory that is Ash Stadium. I've done it before. I could play on Ash, or I could play on another court. I feel like I'm going to vomit because of the result, not because of people watching or what's going on in the stands. That has like zero bearing on it. So yeah, we're kind of just talking through ideas in real time. The simplest one, start at 11. Simplest, like that's an hour. So we've gotten back an hour of sleep. Now, I do want to, like, people are like, the players, like, suck it up. You get to play tennis for late. Listen, if you are back to your hotel by, like, 3:30, your body's already out of its El fucko as far as, like, sleep rhythm already. Like, you're already screwed. You're not going to sleep before 5. And just because you go to bed at 5 doesn't mean that you can sleep for 8 hours. Like, that doesn't happen. Yeah. So you're getting, like, 4 hours. There's no recovery. The next day is like this stunted practice day. You lose half a day recovery, but it's the wrong half of the day recovery. You're losing 3/4 of a day recovery. This was, I get asked all the time, what was US Open was your favorite tournament to play? I go, no, it's like they're a bunch of my favorite memories. But in real time, when you're actually going through the motions of playing 3 night matches a week, it is brutally stressful. Like, it is a problem with recovery. It is a problem. Like, imagine trying to serve a match out in the fourth set, knowing that if you don't, like, you could be another hour and a half, and it just resets all of that recovery. Those are all those things that you kind of have to factor in. Try finding food on site at 4 a.m. Like, it's a graveyard of commerce at 4 a.m. In a place that is like hyper commerce every other part of the day. So, listen, best suggestion, 11. Simplest.
10:30. We just bought ourselves 90 minutes.
And I can't wait for the Jackals. The first time there's a 3-hour delay between day session and night session on Ash, because they started early and because the matches went fast for them to start saying, well, we have nothing to watch. We bought a day session. Say, Levy, I don't know what to tell you, but the easiest move is 11 a.m. What else we got, JW?
What else we got? We got a lot of Americans. There's a bit of turmoil we've talked about several months ago with player development, but insofar as top level players are the ultimate output, so far as we should timestamp this too, right? It's Labor Day.
Yeah.
It's like I don't know.
We're Monday night. The hardcore followers are going to be listening to this Tuesday morning. So we're somewhere in the East Village at night. Iga's currently in the first set. We're keeping an eye on that on a different monitor, and we're doing a show as late as we possibly could to redraw.
Exactly. So as we speak, Tommy Paul, Taylor Fritz looks very good.
Yep.
Francis is still in the draw. Jess Pegula looks very good.
Yep.
Well, preview. Well done. You were a true believer. And Coco was a bit of a disappointment. Evan Navarro was not a disappointment. It's been a very nice tournament for Americans. And, you know, as I say this ironically next to the trivia question answer, but kind of maybe feeling like this could be the year you cease being the answer to a trivia question.
I hope so. This trivia question could legally drink now, so we need to put an end to that. It can order a beer. That's enough. Listen, the first place my mind goes when Alcaraz and Novak lose on back to back nights is like, okay, and they have to be feeling it too. I mean, Francis loves this. He's a lot better on Arthur Ashe Stadium than he is on court 3 at a small event.
Right.
He just is. He gets up for it. He needs to. I actually think he needs to do build the building blocks throughout the year on the court so there's not a million eyeballs. But I also worry zero about him going out on that court and dealing with the expectations. He loves that moment. Taylor Fritz,
he's been terrific.
He requests Louis Armstrong. At some point, and I'm not telling Taylor Fritz anything he doesn't know, at some point, if you want to win this tournament, you got to go into Ashe. You got to go play on Arthur Ashe Stadium. And listen, as we're talking through the draw, like Tommy Paul in center to play the winner of Medvedev feels like a crime based on how open the rest of the draw is now.
Right.
Like, it's
right.
Those are three.
Got good news and bad news for you.
Very informed players, but like that center chicken dinner Medvedev quarter that we were all kind of looking at before the tournament started is still alive and well, and the rest of the draw is just kind of all great players. There's no disrespect, and everyone's bracket got absolutely annihilated. Right?
Is it? I should have this in front of me. Who's got Google? Is it New Mexico or Arkansas? What's the land of opportunity? I just keep saying, is Grigor Dimitrov ever going to have a better chance?
Yeah.
This is just one of these draws where you've got to think, as rational human beings, there are a lot of players thinking, boy, I'm not sure it's ever going to get better than this.
Yeah, and then like the undersold story of the entire event is best player not to have won a major by far, and there's not a close second, is Zverev.
Yeah.
So he's got to be going, okay, I might actually only have to beat one of these, you know, human rubber bands, right. whether it's Sinner, whether it's Medvedev, you know, to deliver that for the first time. Coco, listen, it was I didn't choose her to go far just based on recent form. I like what she acknowledged the serving problems, Yips, in her press conference and said it's fine in practice. Get out there. It's not. I don't know. I feel like this has been such a whirlwind for her. There is no doubt that the second serve is in her head. No doubt. If Corey and Coco were sitting here right now, they would probably tell you the same thing. Yeah. I know Brad would tell me the same thing, not because he has, just because I'm sure he would. You know, so it's a lot of expectation, a lot of spotlight, especially when you're trying to work through things. The spotlight doesn't really matter if you're feeling great, if you're confident. It just is this thing that you have to deal with. Now, you go out there and, you know, the rumble and the mumbles when you hit, you know, 10 or 11 double faults in one set and a third set, those become a lot louder when there's 25,000 people doing it, yep. right? And you kind of feel that weight a little bit more. I just feel like Coco needed to get not out of this tournament, meaning like not play or not try. She always gives all of the mental effort, and she's fighting, you know, some demons right now. But she needed to get past this tournament and the defense of it to really kind of reset and rebuild. Frankly, she has so many things that you can't take away. She's, you know, the most elite mover on tour. You know, ball shape on the forehand. I'd like to see her just completely sell out and find more shape all the time instead of thinking that she has right. to hit forehands as big as Sabalenka. Mm-hmm. Listen, if she hits that looper, it drives traffic to her backhand. That's where she wants to be, right? It's how to get those patterns that you want, not hit the shots that you want. The second serve, it just has to come further left. And it's something that I've worked on with her. Listen, I did a couple sessions with her, you know, and I do think she is fully capable of being an elite server, you know, I don't want to say that because that's the headline, but she is a top three server. She just doesn't know it yet. Yeah. In the world. No, she has 125 in her arm. There needs to be some balance between a 72 mile an hour second serve and 107 mile an hour second serve. I'm totally fine with 89 in the middle of the box when you're struggling. Like, there needs to be this default setting. That's kind of a catch-all. The book is pretty obvious on going to the forehand. I just think having a little bit more shape and not feeling like – that'd be like me going out there and feeling like I had to hit rip backhand winners.
Crush it, yeah.
Like, I wasn't made that way. I didn't have the technique to do that. She's way better on that side than I ever was on my backhand, but her shot shape is her shot shape at this point. And I feel like you need to basically feed that and use it to the best of your ability to get traffic to go a certain way, but take nothing away from Emma Navarro. She has been building. She feels built now. The way she handled that crowd in a weird situation, because obviously everyone loves Coco. She's building quite the fan base herself, and rightfully so.
No, and I think that got lost in this story a little bit.
Yeah.
That here's this player on the other side of the net. She hadn't won a match at the U.S. Open before this year. I don't think she certainly hadn't won a match at Ash, middle weekend, Labor Day weekend. Defending champion, lost that second set, and she just did what she had to do. It was very efficient tennis. I'm wondering, let me ask you a few things. A, have you ever, not obviously perhaps to that degree, but you ever have the yips? You ever have a mental block like that?
No, not like that. I mean, my game was kind of like just yips all the time, but not to that level. You know, my like base setting was if I wasn't feeling good, then I just had to push and try to hold serve, right? I just try to make balls run, make it gross. I was very good at playing bad tennis.
Like, well, so is she, honestly. I mean, she can yes. just hit that point starter second serve, yeah. and great. She's still a 60-40 to win the point.
Yeah, but my life was made easier because the easiest shot for me and the one I knew backwards was the table setter. It was the one that got me into the point or got me short balls, or, you know, I could hide a lot of things based on my ability to either play scoreboard pressure tennis against lesser players, not, you know, the guys that are like the demigods of our sport, but 30 all, make a return, knock one down, hustle a little bit, get the ball up. You know, there are just different ways. That's a lot harder to execute against me if I'm holding it 92% clip at 30 all than it is otherwise. But No, I don't know that I ever had. I wasn't very good a lot of the time, but that wasn't Yips. That was just kind of like a base setting.
You know who looms really large to me in this whole thing? We'll talk about her when we do our redraw, because we don't have to redraw her, but Sabalenka. I mean, I remember those Australian Open matches that were just excruciating.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Giggling.
And
I mean,
this is what I'm telling. This is, if I'm BG, that's literally one of your biggest rivals. We have completely forgotten. And obviously, Sabalenka didn't have like the hype machine of a Coco, you know, but it was still a massive story inside of tennis. It wasn't on full display for mainstream New York to watch. In a night session with expectation, and you know, there are some variables. Sabalenka had the yips in a terrible way. Like,
this isn't like memory hole from the 70s.
No.
This
but
is
like
literally like
Coco,
2 years ago.
Coco was missing. Totally. And she went and over, like, and we've talked about it on this podcast before, like the mental, and the book on her was like, oh, maybe she's not mentally tough. She kind of peaks and valleys. Not everyone has to act the same way. Not everyone has to act like Borg in order to be tough. That narrative has to go to sleep based on what you're alluding to. She had full-blown serving yips to where, and if Sabalenka, you don't listen to this, if you do, turn off the next 2 minutes of this podcast because you don't want to hear this again. But to the point where, like, Coco was at least hitting it square. Like, Sabalenka was hitting it off the frame, like the top of the frame, bouncing.
Serving underhand. Like,
it was like she had given up on hope. And then went back, came back the next offseason before she won her first Australian Open, and it's like she did the work. She retooled. She made adjustments. I'm sure it wasn't easy. There's probably a lot of admissions on it's really hard for an elite athlete to say, I need to rebuild this. Like, I need to break it down, and I need to rebuild it. So if I'm Coco, I'm looking at Sabalenka and going, yeah, I'm closer than a lot of people think on this.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I would just say, listen, you have a colleague who is now contending for majors, and 24 months ago, she had what you had only 8 times worse.
Probably top 3 serves in the world, Rybakina, her, maybe top 2?
Yeah,
right
exactly.
Now?
Right.
Yeah, I mean.
Anyway, can I give you a, before we get to our redraw, can I give you a 30-second riff that just occurred to, you know, this is not something I wrote down or anything?
I don't know. Hold on. Let me check with the producer. Do we have enough time before our next break?
So
we'll take a break after this.
Okay.
So the two remaining American women, just by complete happenstance, have wealthy fathers. Can we retire for once and for all this ridiculous, lazy trope of, for daughters of billionaires, they sure hustle. They sure grind for daughters of billionaires. I don't understand. Like, you drink from the fountain of privilege, but dad's rich. I'm going to let the ball bounce twice. What does your father's wealth have to do with how you play tennis? Second of all, don't a lot of billionaires actually grind? Isn't that how they became billionaires? This whole idea of, like, Emma Navarro and Jess Pegula, it's amazing because their dads are billionaires, and yet they kind of hustle out there on the tennis court. I think it's so lame and lazy and nonsensical and circular. Can we just do away with that?
It is a storyline. I mean, when you're 2 of 2,600 of a certain type of human on Earth, it's going to be a storyline.
But the correlation to the way you play tennis is what gets me.
Well, here's the thing. Let's break this down. You can draw motivation whether it's, hey, I'm going to break out of, my goal is to create a new lifestyle for generations in my family. That's a motivating factor. The motivating factor could be like, hey, I want some elbow room of accomplishment inside of my own house.
Exactly.
Like, it just, how do you get up? How can you motivate? How does, you know, 6 o'clock before you get the track at 7 o'clock look like a good hour to get up? Like, whatever gets you out of bed, whatever makes you jump, whatever can make you consistent with preparation. We as athletes, we kind of brainwash ourselves into finding different points of motivation. There's a certain sense of professionalism. I don't think Ben Navarro made it to where he did by not learning discipline, time management. There are a lot of things that benefit a tennis player that I'm sure Mr. Pegula and Ben Navarro know about. Like, to your point, it doesn't really happen by accident, you know, unless you get given $400 million in 1979, but I digress.
Just
Mike Hayden?
That's just hypothetical.
Yeah, hypothetical.
I mean, I'm friends with Emma Navarro's uncle, you know, and it comes back to the fact that, I mean, they were in sports their whole lives, you know, so I think sports are ingrained in the lexicon of their family, and I think that's probably more it. They just happen to be billionaires, and they probably learned a lot of that from sport, so.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think they're impressive people, and I think it's impressive what you know, these women have been able to do with or without billionaire.
So the more impressive thing, at least from where I stand, and this is maybe another lazy trope that I'm feeding into, is not the fact that we have these two outstanding women playing great tennis. It's not a single person in their locker rooms. Do you ever hear say something? They're entitled. They're inconsiderate. They're
the opposite.
Ever. So that is where you hang your hat. If I'm their fathers, that is what I'm most proud of. Listen, whether they make the semis or the round of 16, it's amazing.
Right.
But also to fight back the narrative of these spoiled brat rich kids, that doesn't exist with these two at all. You would never know. You never hear a whisper or a hint of them being anything less than professional, kind, and considerate 24/7. I'm glad you mentioned that.
All right. Jess Pegula taking the subway to the tennis, for the record. All right.
That's getting a lot of runs. She says saying I haven't done this in decade. And everyone's like, she does it every day. I'm like, no, she doesn't. It was a great piece of PR, and also right. Jim done it. Stop.
Your point is well taken, though. They do not. But my point is just on the tennis court, it's like, oh, I'm not going to get out of the corner. I'm not going to go trace that drop shot dad's in a high tax bracket. All right, let's get on with this, shall we?
Okay.
Let's take a quick break before we get to the drop.
All right, I'm going to have an Olipop break.
Headed to the U.S. Open this year? Be sure to ace the U.S. Open with Chase. As proud sponsor of the U.S. Open, Chase helps tennis fans make the most of their Grand Slam tournament experience with exclusive benefits and perks. Like customer-exclusive Chase Lounge and Chase Terrace, complimentary mobile charger for fans, and more. Head to chase.com/USOpen for more info.
Welcome back to Serve, presented by Chase. I am fully Ollie popped after that break. Hopefully you are too. All right, so redraw show. We're going to go down our brackets. So if you have a draw, have a phone, pull it up. Follow along, or don't. You know, whatever. I'm not...
Don't.
I can't tell you what to do. But let's start with I had Sinner and Paul in the round of 16. As of right now, I think Iga's up 3-1 in the second set of the match. We're here on a Monday night. Delayed shooting this podcast as much as we possibly could for a Tuesday morning release. Techie Sean is going to have to fucking do something with this before Tuesday morning because Mike Hayden is playing hooky. Back in Charlotte.
It's an excused absence.
That's right. Techie Sean gets the L fucko. anyway, so we both had Sinner chicken dinner against Tommy Paul. I like that match hasn't been played yet. By the time you're listening to this, you will know that Sinner won or Tommy Paul won. I still like Sinner in the quarters where he will play Medvedev. Any adjustments on that, John Wertheim?
I think strange as this is to say, I think we may both have gotten this quadrant pretty well right so far.
I will give credit where credit's due. You had Kokkinakis beating Tsitsipas first round.
It's like my one win this whole
tournament. That happened. I had FAA getting to round four. That did not happen. He lost first round. Obviously, you know, my next pick was Nuno Borges to make round four, but you know, c'est la vie, you only get one shot, like Eminem, the great poet Eminem, once said. And this is where shit gets sideways.
This is where things fall apart.
Carlos Alcaraz's bracket. You had him losing to Boric Van Dizzy, didn't you?
Yeah, I mean, because he had had such a good year coming in, the dangerous Dutchman.
He was 11-18. On the year.
We want to hear a really funny story real quick.
Yeah.
When I was living in Amsterdam, someone very nice, I don't know, someone I think listened to this podcast, said, you want to come down? You can play at our club. I'd love to have you as my guest. It's where Bodek van der Zandschulp, this was written so I didn't have to pronounce it.
That's pretty well
it's
done.
It's where he plays, and if you're lucky, you'll probably see him there because he's not going to last on tour much longer. He's about to retire. And I'm thinking, if your own recreational Dutch tennis club is retiring you, you're probably not very long for this tour. So the guy who's like fellow members, like, you know, driving the Audi at the Dutch tennis club are retiring you. It doesn't say great things about and here he is beating Carlos Alcaraz in straight sets.
It made no sense at all.
This is my draw is just a battlefield of
dumpster
misses
fire.
Here. Yeah, exactly.
That's offensive. I had Draper losing to Alcaraz. And then I had Sebastian Korda, who got
Mahatched.
Drilled by Mahat. That scoreline is stunning for me for Seb Korda. Again, I think you touched on it in your mailbag. Like the eye test when he's playing well, he can take the racket out of your hands. And then there's a, you know, I was on a flight and I look at this, I land and look at the score line. It's like 4-2-4. Like that's significant. Like that's a, yeah, that's a loss. Especially coming in with some momentum, winning DC and making the, I think it was the semis in Canada. Anyway, so we have Draper through to the quarters.
Good for him.
Yeah, and by the way, I wanted to touch on him. I had him written down in the open. One of my favorite parts of this show is pointing out progress. Jack Draper's, and I critique only to build up in a second. His backhand was very average, and that's coming from someone whose backhand was maybe less than average. So, two things that have improved. He used to also make like weird errors. He's looked rock solid so far. The serve is there. I walk past him in the locker room. He's a big dude.
Big boy. Yeah.
He is not.
That was his brother, by the way. But yeah,
I don't know.
Boy.
I don't know his brother, but I walk past him. I'm like, oh, that's a mammal. Like that's a big mammal. Backhand is way better. Breaking serve at a clip that he hasn't seen before. Lot of progress in his game, regardless of how it goes from here. Demon is still on court. Can I get a score update with Thompson in real time? It looks like he is going to advance.
4-4 in the fourth.
So he's up 2-1, 4-4 in the fourth. The matchup is a tough one for Jordan Thompson. Just can't create enough speed off that forehand side. I'll say that, and then we'll wake up in the morning, and Jordan Thompson will have won. So who knows? Do you like Draper or the Demon to get through?
That's a tough one.
To their first semi?
I was worried about the Demon only because after that injury he suffered at Wimbledon.
He hasn't played.
He didn't play a singles match.
Impressive.
And then he comes here, and he's winning on Labor Day weekend. That's a tough call. I don't know the head to head there. I'll say the Demon.
I'm gonna go Draper. He's just gonna serve. Like it takes a massive serve to kind of affect Demon in the right way. He doesn't miss a lot of returns. He's as fast. And the thing that I don't like when people are talking about Demon is he is very, very fast, but he can get forward. Like he likes coming in. He doesn't have that like spin profile of someone who likes to play D. He is very fast, but he's not, you know, he keeps the ball down a la Medvedev, right? That little pokey backhand where it doesn't get up, begs you to attack him, but he likes coming forward. He is a complete player, great volleyer. People don't talk about his all-court game enough because he's so fast. I like Draper, you like Demon. Who are you going to take up top, center and Medvedev?
Do we like the Slim Reaper nickname, by the way, for Medvedev? I feel like
Slim Shady.
I don't know. I
Slim Jim.
I'm gonna take kind of like Medvedev actually. I mean, he had no momentum coming into this event, and he's looked terrific. I mean, he's barely dropping games, and part of this is probably hard overhead. Just think he's a good tennis citizen in general. Won this thing obviously 3 years ago. I'll go Medvedev. Why not?
I had Medvedev originally. I had him losing to Alcaraz. I'm going to stick with him, but has nothing to do with. So I'll tell you the way that this matchup went. I want to say it's 7-5 Medvedev overall, but it was, I want to say it was 6-0 Medvedev. Then Sinner from the end of last year through Wimbledon, where he lost, Sinner lost to Medvedev. Sinner had won 5 in a row. So Medvedev put a halt to that. I thought it was pretty surprising at Wimbledon. Obviously, we didn't know kind of the mental turmoil that Sinner was dealing with, and you know, he had his own kind of secrets that he was kind of going through. So who knows how that plays out? But yeah, I'm not mad at you. Medvedev, Draper. Are you gonna take? You're not gonna take Demon over Medvedev, are you?
No,
so we both have Medvedev in the final.
Yep.
Wow. All right. So we have, you picked, this is now we're getting into a section where you're going to look real good.
Layla Fernandez, are we there yet?
Sure.
All right.
We both got that.
I had
Fritz in the semis.
Oh, good.
And I want to,
I'll stick with that.
I want to say there's no chance you had Zverev losing before the quarters. So I think you have Zverev Fritz in the quarters and you're still going Fritz.
Yeah.
I'm going.
You changed.
It's the same. Right. I had Rude. Over Fritz, which is just really dumb, but Fritz had lost 2 first rounds in a row coming off the Olympics. So that's it. It was looking back, that was pretty stupid. But Rude just hit the physical wall. He had a tough five-setter against Shang and then just, like, went away at the end with Fritz. But credit to Fritz. He's been playing great. He will have to go into Arthur Ashe at some point. He's going to he's gonna have to leave the friendly confines of Armstrong. There was a journalist online who was, like, who was on Twitter, and I kind of popped off a little bit. I won't name names, but he basically said, oh, the hype machine, Fritz gets put out on Armstrong all the time while the others and Shelton and Tiafo and Coco, you know, all get the hype and it's disrespectful. I'm like, he fucking requests to be there.
Yeah, exactly.
He's literally getting his way.
Right, right.
Like, you're making him sound like a he's like, oh, I knew that. I'm like, what? You knew that? That's a weird way to make your argument then. Like, whatever. I have Zverev in the semis. In the bottom section, I had Rubles. Rublev, and I did not have Tiafo. I had Novak Djokovic. So it is now Dimitrov and Francis.
Ooh. Can we agree on this? If Francis has a chance at another semi and doesn't get by Dimitrov, lovely guy, nice player to watch, you can't ask for much more than that from Francis at the quarterfinal of a major. A guy who's
conversely, I would say Dimitrov's going. You give Dimitrov, if you tell him a month ago you get Francis in the quarters, he's pumped. Like, Francis was a ghost for most of this season, by the way. And he's playing great now. I saw him before the tournament. We kind of talked about it. He's like, yeah. And I was like, everything looks like it kind of like when you have it and you find it finally. Everything, and I kind of motioned my hand like this, and he goes, slows down. I'm like, it all slows down. The decisions become a little bit easier. You don't feel frantic. You don't feel rushed. You don't feel desperation. He kind of found that this summer, and I fully credit skipping the Olympics, by the way. Getting matches in D.C., getting matches. That was the right decision.
Yeah.
We like to criticize people. That was the absolute spot-on, nail on the head, right decision for him. Dimitrov, Tiafoe.
I'm going Francis. I think he'll play off the crowd. Dimitrov had a really nice win over Rublev, but it went 3:38. Nice conditions here. Big crowd energy. I'm thinking we get an American semi. Do I even say that?
I hope you're right.
What do you got?
I have Zverev.
Oh, you have Zverev.
Yeah, I have Zverev, Tiafoe. I don't even know that, like, Dimitrov's playing great. Like, I'm about to be a massive hypocrite. Probably not the first time. But I often go after JW because he makes his picks with the story that he wants to write like a week from now. he likes to work backwards from the story he wants to write.
Working on Dimitrov's story,
yeah.
Are you?
He already has a mailbag. Oh, in America. Like, he's had that mailbag written for 12 years.
Giving up the game here.
I am... American in the final. Tiafoe in the final.
Sold.
Let's go. Tiafoe in the final. And I don't even want to break it down. I just want it to be what it is. I want to be in the building. I want it all to end. I want it to all end. I want it to go away. I want it.
That's very gracious of you. Other athletes in your position who want to, like, drink from that faucet.
Oh,
as long
God,
as
the
can.
Faucet. Listen, I've gotten more juice out of the squeeze than any human has ever gotten out of anything ever.
You and Fred Perry.
Correct. Like, and I guess I can't take him. I can't take him in a head-to-head matchup against Medvedev. Just based on matchup, I'm putting Francis in the final, but I can't pick against Medi. I think I have Medi winning.
All right, but I got just type. We're hypothetical land here, obviously. Francis doesn't beat Fritz, does he?
That's up to you. I didn't have him. I had Zverev.
No, I have Fritz. I have Fritz beating Francis.
You have Fritz in the final against Medi.
Yep.
Okay. Are you going to do it? Are you going to do it? You think,
man.
Is Fritz going to do it?
Put me on the... fuck. Why not?
All right. you have Taylor Fritz winning the U.S. Open.
Sure, why not? All jokes aside and all, like, he's been terrific so far.
Yeah?
I mean, his serving has been great. He no drama. I mean, he's really looked like someone capable of winning majors. Why not? Taylor Fritz, your 2024 U.S. Open champ.
Oh my gosh!
Saying that on Labor Day.
We both have a final. We are willing this to happen. By the way, I just want Fritz to get Tiafoe to get on one. I would love Fritz Tiafoe semi. I would love to guarantee a U.S. finalist. For the first time in a long time, I would love nothing more than for an American to win on Sunday. That would just light That would fill my cup up. I hope it's one of those two. And we don't know if Tommy Paul's left is still in the tournament. By the time you're listening to this, we both chose center, so we're acting off of that assumption. But Tommy Paul could very much be in this conversation as well. I hope he is. We will see. But you have the old T. Fritz walking into Ash, having not played there, just rewriting history.
I love the dynamic here. Usually it's monkey off the back. Usually the burden is on like the Chicago Cubs that they haven't won. You're feeling unburdened by getting this. Like you won this thing. Like you're good, and you're feeling like you need to unburden yourself.
No, it's not unburdening me. I hate it. I get this anxious feeling every time they have to answer for it. I fucking hate it for them. I absolutely hate it for them. I just want it. I want them to have it. I want them to clear. And frankly speaking, if one of them breaks this thing, they could start contending regularly. Like the dam breaks and then it goes. Like this, they don't have to play against ghosts. Like they don't have to play against ghosts. So I hope it happens. We'll see. I think I had Medi going through just because I had him beating center, and my ego won't let me go back on that. So not my ego, my ego. Ooh.
Speaking of which,
segue. Thank you. I've been podcasting for months. I'm pretty much great at it now.
Hey there, Chuckers. You know, I used to rely on precision, power, and maybe a little bit of innovation to keep my serve untouchable. Well, turns out those same things aren't just for tennis. They're for racing, too. Who knew? Since 2017, Lexus Racing has been doing exactly that. Precision, power, and a whole lot of innovation. Last year, they teamed up with Vassar Sullivan and snagged the 2023 IMSA GTD Pro Class Championship with their Lexus RCF GT3. And let me tell you, that car has got more horsepower than I ever had in my serve. Don't tell my ego. But like any good athlete, one win just isn't enough. All right, a little too personal, but that's fine. They're back and they're gunning for another title in 2024. You can't miss those Dayglo yellow and black Lexus RCF GT3 race cars on the track. And if you do somehow miss them, you'll definitely hear those V8 engines roaring louder than my victory yell after a big match. So if you want to see what happens when you mix tennis-worthy precision with race car power, follow Lexus Racing every weekend. Head over to Lexus.com/motorsports to learn more about Lexus Racing and get all the details on upcoming races.
What do we have for a score update with Iga?
She's up 5-1.
All right, so
serving
that's,
right now.
All right, so I'm going to operate under the assumption that Samsonova doesn't come back from a set in 5-1 down against the number one player in the world. Iga in the quarters, Jess Pegula in the quarters. I took Pegula to the final. So I'm not going to fade anyone that I chose at the beginning of the tournament unless there's something massive. Hard to pick against Iga when she gets going, but I'm sticking with Jess.
I can't even remember what I had. 6-3 head-to-head.
Oh, I know what you had.
What do I have?
You had You had Mira Andreeva in the final.
We love her.
Yeah. you had Mira Andreeva. And by the way, I'll tell you, you were on air. I was watching one morning. Obviously, I had nothing going on.
You're the one.
I was watching one morning when you were making your picks, and Prakash chose Osaka in an upset over Mucho. I'm like, get out of here. But Chanda Rubin, upset of the day, chose Ashlyn Kruger over Andreeva.
That's a pick, huh?
And what happened?
That's a pick, huh?
Ashlyn Kruger over Andreeva. Your entire bracket is just...
Yeah, smithereens.
Smithereens. Like Iga Pegula.
Start. Trotter, Kimbetti.
Redo it. We have the mics. They can't stop us.
6-3 Iga.
All of Jess's three wins have been on a hard court. Iga won... Let's see. Iga won 2 years ago in the quarters, 3-6 or 4-6, something like that. I was there.
In New York,
in the quarters 2 years ago.
If it hadn't been for Cotton Eye Joe, she might have beaten her in Canada. But
do
you remember that?
I do. That was
when they played the.
Just Google it.
Anytime I see Iga Pegula, I just think of the random Cotton Eye Joe speaker malfunction. Anyway,
it was literally a speaker malfunction in Canada where it just uncontrollably was going. Get up, deep, Cotton Eye Joe, baby, baby,
lumbander. North Carolina
in the middle of the match.
That's got to be it.
It was just in the middle of the match.
Literally mid-rally.
And then, if I remember it correctly, like the tide turned post-Joe.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. So anyways, but like...
Yeah. That's got to be a top five worst song of all time, by the way.
Thank you for listening to Served, presented by Chase. Give us another chance. We're better than this. Let's go.
Yeah. And now we get that earworm Cotton Eye Joe. I think... He married a long time ago. I got to say... Gosh, I don't know. I mean,
you got married a long time ago.
It's a lyric, right?
Yes.
All right.
Iga Pagula, go.
Just Pagula, why not? Playing well on these courts. I still think Iga, I mean, she's winning. She seems much more comfortable with these fast courts, but I don't know. I don't think she's, I think she's one of these players who doesn't necessarily love this tournament, doesn't love New York, and she's got sort of everything sort of collides
in
that semifinal match.
I'm telling you something that I think is going to happen and I think is not going to be granted. I would almost bet a kidney that Pagula will request day, ball flies through the court a little bit faster, and that's not possible. With Iga and Jess Pagula, I think they have to play it night on Ash, but I guarantee you that Team Pagula will be requesting that match during the day. We will see.
I'm trying to do in my head what it would contend. She might have a shot at a...
I don't know.
I think, can Jess make her uncomfortable? Can Iga have an off service? I kind of like the way Jess is playing. I think the surface really favors her.
Jess is digging out of the corners. Like, she normally is, she's a great ball striker from the middle of the court. She is hitting on the run, like when she gets a little bit extended, as well as I've ever seen her do before. For me, this matchup, Iga Jess, is who's going to get to munch on second serves, right? Like, if someone serves 60%, they're going to win this match. Put that out there right now. If someone serves 60%, I think they win the match. Both of them love to attack second serves. Neither one of them has a good second serve.
Right.
It based on the shadow of everything else in their games, right?
Right.
Probably above, you know, two average for Iga, but like compared to the rest of it, you're not scared of their second serves.
And sometimes we say, well, Iga's going to turn this into a track meet. Great. That doesn't faze Jess Pagula.
But
she
Iga,
can go side to side. Iga
isn't like a sprinter. Her athleticism, by the way, if you can ever ISO watch, so only watch one half of the court, if you have a junior tennis player in your house, make them ISO watch Iga Świątek's footwork all the time. She has this side of Steffi.
I was going to say, we're going back to Steffi Graf.
Steffi.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah.
I mean, her footwork, and not extended. Extended, she's great. There's a lot of people who on the run are very good. Her circle C movement, getting the forehand, the quick movements off the mark, something she works on all the time, it's as good as I've seen. Like, that is, it is elite. Elite, 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 elite. Watch Iga. I like Jess Pagula in this match. Hajaj? Not good at the...
Maya, Brazilian, lefty.
And Muchova.
I can't believe I'm saying this. This is a really nice story. Muchova's semifinalist last year, so you say, okay, she'll be back in the semis. Her journey from last year to this year...
She didn't play for 9 months.
I mean, she didn't play for 9 months. Haddad Maya also, nice player, big hitter, lefty.
Yeah.
She lost in the final of Cleveland like 9 days ago to McCartney Kessler. I mean, talk about your fortunes changing in 9 days. Now you're suddenly in a major quarter. I think Muchova, who is such a good athlete,
she could
such
win this tournament. I'm just
she
telling you,
she
can win this tournament.
And
also coming back after not having played and playing Grand Slam level tennis, I mean, and also arguably the toughest draw so far, like had to go through Osaka, had to go through Paolini.
Yeah,
she is and rolling, like she rolled Paolini.
Yeah,
and Paolini's
rolled Osaka.
Yeah, I mean, she's the Muchova looks amazing. I can't. I'm gonna. We'll just get this one while we're here. I'm gonna pick Pagula just because I did, but Muchova could win this tournament. I'm just telling you, she is playing elite tennis. I had Emma Navarro and Paula Badosa. I had Badosa in the semis.
Ooh, wait. Take a minute there. That's a good call.
Yeah, I had I think you had Krejcikova, I think. I had Badosa in the semis, if I remember correctly, over Azarenka in round four. I had
Coco coming out of
that. I had Coco losing to I had Badosa Navarro in the quarters. And I'm gonna stick with it even though I want Navarro.
Wait, you had Badosa Navarro?
Yeah, I had Badosa.
That's a good call.
Thank you.
For a wide open draw?
Thank you.
Wait, that's a
shooter.
Two New York City natives.
Yeah.
Two New York City native born players.
Oh, that's a good.
Boy, I don't
that's
know.
A good little nugget.
Can I tell you? I just learned that like yesterday that Bedosa was born in New York. I had no idea.
I don't think I knew that. I don't think I knew that.
I think her parents were a model or something. I think her mom was a model and she happened to be in New York.
Whose parents weren't models?
Yeah, exactly.
What about you, Techie Sean?
I was going to say.
Mike?
Not so much.
Flembot?
Yeah, all 5'2". Of them.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, why don't you just, can you just cough? Can you just cough on us real quick? It's just, oh, God. Man.
That's a good, like I can say, that's a good effort.
Are we going to be able to see producer Mike on the show? God, yeah. He looks disgusting.
Can I
right
say,
now.
Like, we're like knuckleheads talking about tennis and Cotton Eye Joe. We got a poor guy with COVID. He's got us. Let's wrap this up.
He has it right
Emma
now.
Emma Navarro beats Paula Badosa, I think. I'm all in on Emma Navarro.
I wish I had Badosa in the semis. I'm not going to reverse that call. Right, now it's Sabalenka. I have Sabalenka over Badosa. Do you have Sabalenka over Navarro? How all in on Navarro are you? Because you just said
no. I pick Sabalenka to start.
Okay.
I mean, all in as in I'm a.
All right, I have Sabalenka. I started Sabalenka over Pegula, and wow. I'm still Sabalenka over Pegula.
Wait, I got to say, for all the self-effacing, like, our draws are dumpster fires, especially given how wide open the women's draw is, the fact that, A, both your finalists remain, and you had a Badosa-Navarro quarter?
I had a Badosa-Navarro quarter, yeah.
That's strong. I picked Sabalenka to start, and I will stick with her.
Yep. All right, so you have Taylor Fritz winning the men. I have Medvedev winning the men. Listen, I want American men especially because obviously it's been a minute. I want that place ripping. I want it ripping. Taylor, Francis, great. Ripper Magoo. That's what we're going for. That's what we're going for. Any last thoughts? I just want to, again, I want to say Mukova is like one of my favorite players to watch.
Right.
One of the most versatile. I don't know how she hasn't been great for like.
She can't stay healthy.
For like 10 years.
Yeah,
like
right.
Every time I watch her, I'm like, she is legit good. Like really, really good.
I remember she beat Ash Barty in Australia. I hope I have this right. She beat Ash Barty and Ash Barty referred to as a jockey jock jock.
Yeah, yeah.
Which might be like an Aussie term, but. She might be one of the top five most athletic players. Yeah, Barty wasn't a slouch.
Ash Barty calling someone jockey jock jock is like David Robinson calling Shaq tall.
Yeah, exactly.
Like that's kind of where we're at. But anyways, that's what we got. Hopefully your draws were good. Hopefully your redraws were good. I feel like the redraws were extremely necessary with the departures of – oh, I need – one more thing is like if I choose – on the women's side, someone to go to the semis, there's a 50-50 shot they pull out of the tournament. Because I chose Rybakina to go to the semis, and nope. I chose Sabalenka to win Wimbledon. Nope. So
let's be clear. We're talking, these aren't outright defeats. These are like DNPs.
No, these are
like. Did not post.
Did not play.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I don't know. Like for the safety of all the women players in the draws, maybe we just skip the next draw show. Luckily, it's not for months and months. Anything else, JW, or is that a wrap? We're gonna go figure out a place to get a slice in New York.
Yeah, let's get some pizza.
Perfect. That's it for Served, presented by Chase. Thank you for watching. I'm sure we'll be back with you either on a quick served or something else this week. Just stay tuned as always. We appreciate you watching. We appreciate you caring. And thank you to all of you that have been coming to the live shows. Those are a blast. We had a great one with Seal. Last week, if you haven't checked that one out, you have to. I feel like I should have paid him like a professor's salary at the end of that. He was
or therapist
able to connect the dots between what he does, the excellence that he creates, and how he views the excellence of tennis, and kind of made it look or made it seamless, which was very cool. So check that one out. That'll be up on YouTube. Check us out, Apple, Spotify, all of the things. Props, Techie Sean, Mike. Feel better. We'll see you next time on Served. Cheers.